and welcome to the Parenting Roundabout podcast for the week of August 7th. I'm Catherine Haleko, and I'm here with Terri Morrow.
Hello.
Previously on this podcast, we chatted about what parents were talking, complaining, and obsessing about each week, and we brought you short daily episodes. But these days, we're bringing you a weekly roundup to talk about parenting in a more roundabout way. So today, we're going to start off with pet parenting, right?
That's right.
How's it going? You have Layla for...
It's been a little over a month. Yeah. Okay. And she has fit right in. She knows the schedule. She comes by me at 6 o'clock in the evening and starts to whine because she knows that's about when I knock off and we go for a walk. She and my husband and I. So she's got that down, and she's still with the laying completely across hallways thing. And she can lay in the entrance to the kitchen in such a way that you cannot get into the kitchen. So fortunately, we have two doors, but I don't know if she's waiting for somebody to give her something and so then she'll, like, provide access or what.
Right. But
one thing I've noticed that's been different in dog parenting from when I was kid parenting, kids who sort of had trouble from time to time making friends. And this dog already has three friends in the neighborhood. We take her for walks and we see Hannah. Hi, Hannah. Hannah is a very white dog. Layla is a very black dog. They look like a photo negative. It's adorable. And then there's Bailey. Hi, Bailey. Sometimes Bailey is happy to see her. Sometimes Bailey is a little snippy. But, you know, it's that way with friends. And then my husband has this other walk that he takes to a different neighborhood. And there's a dog named Orion there who's always very happy to see Layla. And my husband said one time they just turned the corner and they're walking down the street and he saw Orion and her owner just about to turn a corner. And the owner did not see Layla coming, but Orion did. And Orion refused to turn the corner. And in fact, at one point, just plopped down on the grass. Like, I'm waiting for my friend.
My friend
ain't
is
going
coming.
Anywhere. It just tickles me to know that she's got these little, you know, we walk along and Hannah's mom sees us and brings her out and they play. And so, or they sniff each other is really what happens. But
Right. It's
nice. Wouldn't it be nice if it was that easy to just make friends with somebody? You just go sniff their butt and suddenly you're pals.
Right. Like, okay, now we're friends.
You smell okay.
Yeah.
But then every time we meet, I will smell you again just to be sure.
Just double check.
Oh, no rhetorical flourishes needed, no advanced language skills, no understanding of nuance and turns of phrase.
Nope,
no possibility that they're going to go gossip with you with all the other girls if you say the wrong thing. Nope, just put up your tail, let me smell your butt. Okay, we can be friends. Dogs. Dogs are adorable. How are your dogs, Catherine?
Mine are fine. They're trying to protect us from possums in our yard.
Oh,
so,
dear.
I mean, you might remember, like, months ago, they encountered one in the backyard. Well, first of all, we've found more than one dead one in our backyard.
Oh, no.
Yes. And then at one point, there was a live one, and that was... very dramatic.
Yeah.
You know, there was a lot of barking and hissing and running around in circles. And
that was just you.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. That was me having an absolute freak out. And then just a couple of weeks ago, well, first, like a few weeks before that, I found another dead one, like, in the yard. And it was not an adult. It was not a fully grown, but it wasn't like a tiny baby. Mm-hmm. It was like an adolescent possum in the yard and like in the exact same spot where one of the other ones was. And my husband was like, what is going on? Like, who is throwing dead possums in our yard?
Oh my gosh.
I'm like, I don't think that's what happened. But anyway, I'm like, you know.
The latest,
like,
high school prank, throwing dead possums in people's backyard. Even more fun than cow tipping.
And so then that happened. And then, like, a few weeks later, once again in the evening, you know, the barking outside where I can tell it's not just talking to the neighbor dogs or whatever. It's something's
up.
And, yes, go outside and... another, like, teenage possum, but it's in a tree. It's in a like a large lavender like bush between our house and our neighbors. So it's up in the tree and the dogs are under it, you know, barking at it like crazy. And so at least this time I was able to just drag them inside, and that was that. Like, it wasn't like they were actually all on the ground together like they were last time. But, what is going on? Stop it. I don't need to see any more. I mean, I know their possums are good. They eat ticks. Like, they're great. But they can eat ticks somewhere else.
Exactly. Please. No ticks here. Thank you. Move along. Well.
Wildlife.
Life, wildlife, and domesticated life.
Yes.
And life on TV shows.
That's right. So let's move on to our two shows that we're watching right now. The After Party and Brothers and Sisters. So starting with The After Party, this episode was Sebastian.
All along, Sebastian was really a punk from San Bernardino. Is he a Brit with a good American accent or an American with a good British accent? The actor.
I think he's a Brit with a not that great American accent, is my opinion.
At any rate, an amusing twist.
Yes. And we got, you know, in the manner of this show, we got to see, you know, go back and see how some things happened. Uh-huh. Realize that a couple of people, the DJ and one of the cater waiters, uh-huh, were actually Sebastian's cousins and cronies.
who he got out of jail, giving us an opportunity to see the culprit from last season.
Yes.
Ben Schwartz. Putting on a little show.
Jasper. Yes, that was fun. For a second, I was like, wait, is he going to get?
Yeah.
No, he's not. He's not his cousin. Yeah, so.
Just a little wink to those who watched season one.
That's right. And those who enjoy Ben Schwartz.
Absolutely.
Pretty funny in the right dosage, which this was.
This was. Just a little dash, a soupçon of Ben Schwartz in the middle of our caper comedy.
That's right. So, yeah, it was definitely a caper, you know, with
lots of Ocean's 11 throwbacks, I thought.
Right. And, you know, double cross and switcheroos and that kind of thing.
Yeah. And Edgar, who's been kind of a cipher in a lot of this, not a nice dude.
Yeah. At least in this
he was
portrayal,
a
for sure.
Villain. Mm-hmm. Kind of wouldn't say sadistic necessarily, but cutting the guy's baseball card is pretty nasty.
Right.
So it's a whole new facet to him. He seemed, that's in right, everybody else's story, to be sort of a blank.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. Who's telling the truth?
And it was a clever security measure that the retina scanner was for the pet lizard, not a human.
Yes.
I love that.
Nicely figured out. Right, mm-hmm, to the end, and mm-hmm, I was amused by all the high stakes Connect Four being played. that's a game we play in our house fairly commonly. Mm-hmm. Not the mm-hmm light up version with gold coins, but still
gold coins. Yeah,
I never knew it could be so treacherous.
That's right.
You don't necessarily,
and they did, you know. They usually at the, you know, toward the end of each episode kind of point to who they're going to zero in on next. And this one, it turns out it's going to be Danner herself. But they also went after Isabel. They went after Vivian, who's Grace and Zoe's mom.
Right.
Then they returned to Grace and Hannah.
Uh-huh.
So,
and they also, something about Ulysses, maybe putting something in a drink.
Right.
So
right.
I want his story. And I want Elizabeth Perkins' showcase. And mm-hmm, we have to wait to get backstory on Danner.
Yeah. Who we already know from last year.
Which I'm sure it will be entertaining and have something to do with this story, but it feels like pace-wise, really? Really, right here is where you want to put that?
Right.
I don't know. Did not thrill me when I noticed that. But, okay. It's a short... these episodes aren't that long.
A helicopter coming over my house right now. Can you hear that?
Maybe they're surveilling us. Maybe that's why that's our connection keeps getting bad. They're on to us, Catherine. They've been sending cryptocurrency secrets through our coded in our conversations.
If we had cryptocurrency, we wouldn't need to be in the lucrative world of podcasting.
Anyway, so
I didn't really understand either why Elizabeth Perkins' character, why did she tell Sebastian the code that he needed?
Yeah, I didn't understand any of that.
Okay.
And I also don't understand why Sebastian thinks that he should be exonerated by the fact that all he took was the baseball card.
Right.
Still seems like he had a motive to kill him, especially if the safe was still open. But, or he knows how to open it now.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Seems like you would have had reason to want him dead for many years of him lording things over you and firing you and... you know, now you can take over the business. So,
right.
He's still on my list. But it's probably not him.
Right.
I don't know. It's moving along.
It is moving
along. I said last week that it seemed like people were staying there for days. Why would they stay? But I guess this is all supposed to be the same day.
I guess this is all like the day after the wedding.
It seems very long to us because we were hearing an episode's worth of story every time. But I guess she's chatting with each person.
She's going one by one through each person.
Why did we not want to call the police? We don't know yet.
That's something between Isabel and Sebastian.
Right.
Isabel is the one who's like, we're not calling the police now. So
she still can't hold them there, though.
No.
But we do know that the property has, like, lights and alarms and all this stuff, so I suppose it might be hard to sneak off.
That may come
up. She could take things out of all their cars, I guess. I don't know. Probably I'm overthinking this, but... So that was fine. I watched this one with my husband, actually. He was curious to watch an episode of it. I don't think he's going to want to watch any more. It was fine, but kind of coming in the middle. You know, he was asking questions like, why are they talking to this detective if she's not a detective? It's like, well, but you see last season and, you know, well, because it's a TV show.
And just don't ask questions. Leave the questions to her.
But it also meant that I was watching it on a TV, so I couldn't hear everything quite as well. And I couldn't even read the captions. So, so it floated by my eyeballs and seemed fine.
Right.
But not would have liked to heard another story next week.
Yeah.
But sure. Okay. Fine.
Yeah. Next week it's called Danner's Fire.
Yeah.
So it's outside the naming convention.
It is.
And
outside the pool of suspects.
Yeah.
Just gonna take.
I feel like they did this last time.
They did, but I think they did it closer to the end. Wasn't it like the next to last episode?
Having
it here in the middle seems odd when we haven't heard from, like, the more interesting suspects.
Right.
But I trust that it will shine light on something in such a way that it will be worth it.
Right.
It better. It should.
And speaking of things that are worth it, question mark.
And things that maybe there won't be a next week of.
Right. Brothers and Sisters.
Oh, my goodness. So
this was episode 15. No, 16.
Episode 16. End of the road.
Season 2. The last episode of season 2. Prior commitments. As you know, we're going to kind of bookend the season with another wedding, right?
Yes.
Because we had Kitty and Robert earlier on, and now we have Scotty and Kevin.
Yeah.
After Kevin makes an ill-advised trip to Arizona.
Yeah, to see Scotty's parents, who are named Wally and Bertha.
Come on now.
Just as shorthand for, we don't have to really have them say anything. You know what they're like, Wally and Bertha. Know. But Bertha is a little more hard-ass than Wally, who very sweetly gives Kevin a set of cufflinks to give to Scotty that he had promised Scotty could wear when he got married.
Yes, that was very sweet.
And Scotty is very moved to receive them, and it keeps him from being angry at Kevin for having to gone to see
his parents. For having done that.
Without permission.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, so.
Yeah, and, you know, as is to be expected, the wedding is at Nora's house, and she brings in an entire florist shop.
Just some clippings from her yard.
Yes.
Well, she's forbidden to do any food because Scotty's doing all the food. So she has to she has to do something. Come on.
She has to do something. And she apparently, yes.
Yes. Hopefully nobody has flower allergies because they're going to be in a bad way.
Yeah, that's not going to go well.
We have the whole family there plus various extras who we don't know who they are. They're friends of Scotty. They're Scotty's friends. Sure. That's
fine. Right. I hope he has some friends. I mean, they should have brought the friends from the gay bar.
Yeah.
Like, they've shown that he has friends.
Right. Oh, well. Miscellaneous people. Once again, we get another glimpse of Sarah's children. Though the ex-husband doesn't come back for the wedding, but the kids are there. And I enjoyed that. Paige's job, Karis Dorsey's job in this is to have a heartfelt conversation with her mother in which she passes on some wisdom that will be helpful. And the little boy who plays Cooper, his job is to just hang on Justin's shoulders at all times. So.
Right.
That little boy's got a good gig. He just comes on every now and then, and he acts like a little boy, and everybody smiles.
Yeah, he didn't have to see his grandfather die.
No.
He didn't have to get diabetes and get stuck with needles all the time.
He just jumps on somebody's back, and he's good. Mm-hmm. Nice work if you can get it. So that gets resolved. And of course, when they're having the wedding, I enjoyed how every time they showed Kevin and Scotty, Saul was framed right in the middle of them. So he comes.
Guess what? I'm gay too.
He comes in later to a room full of siblings and assumes that Kevin has told them, which is a reasonable assumption.
It is quite reasonable.
Yes.
It is
and
not
so
what's
he says,
happening, but yeah.
So you all are talking about me. Well, yes, I'm gay. And of course, none of them knew that. Which actually happened earlier, didn't it? When they were all talking about Rebecca not being a walker, and then Kevin walked in and assumed that they were all talking about his wedding.
Yes.
People, really, walk into a room, get a sense of what the discussion's about.
Read it.
Before you make assumptions. Reasonable assumptions in both cases, and yet there are so many secrets to be discussed. It's not necessarily your secret that's being talked about at the moment. Take a number and stand in line.
That's right.
This stupid show, spends 2 years on this secret sister plot line.
Right.
And then it turns out she's not really their sister. And then that would be frustrating enough. They could just leave that be.
Right.
But no. Who's the R then? Who could the R be? There must be another secret sibling. Who's the other R?
That's the only conclusion that one could
absolutely
draw in this
not
situation.
Just that he might add one at the end just to mess it up, which is what I would do, right? That's what anybody would do. It's a terrible password anyway, so you throw in something that's wrong. Just to make it a little stronger. But no, it must be something. And then Kevin has this memory. Kevin is thinking back to his own father, who was not quite as upset as Bertha about his life choices, but still not as welcoming as he might have hoped.
Right.
And in the course of this memory, just happens to be some mention of somebody named Ryan. Mm. And a picture of a baby. Who's this baby? Oh, that's Ryan, the child of my friend who died, says the dad. And so, of course.
Also, can I just point out that picture looks like it's from 1950, not it does. 1990. Or
why are they assuming it's somebody who's like Rebecca's age?
Yes.
So, just fortunately, fortuitously, the memory of him and his dad trying to come to terms with his lifestyle comes the memory that, oh, yes, that picture. I have seen that picture before. Mm-hmm. It's Ryan.
And also, he leaves. It's his wedding night. He just
yes, he leaves bolts. Scotty.
He leaves Scotty a post-it and hits the road.
It's like, what about this?
Yes.
Needs to be addressed immediately.
Yeah.
Why does... You can't even pick up the phone and tell Sarah, you'll never guess what I remembered. I'll talk to you tomorrow.
No.
And then, I mean, I guess it's the next morning, but still, immediately they have to go tell Nora.
Yes, they have to convene yet another family.
What is wrong with you people? Let it lie. I mean, the first time worked out so well.
Right.
Why not try it again? But I did kind of like the way they segued from Kevin and Sarah telling Nora and Nora looking stricken to Secret Sister 1.0 and Justin on this beautiful hillside looking over a lovely vista and kissing for the first time. So, you know, as one storyline moves on, another begins.
Mm-hmm.
Does it have to, really? Anybody? Does anybody want to go through this again? Raise your hand. You? No? No? What the heck? It was a stupid plot line. It would have been over on the second episode if they had done a DNA test.
Right.
This is all that needed to happen. Right. Who would not do a DNA test? Yeah. But no, they let it go on for two bleeping seasons and then say, oh, hey, we were wrong. What do you know? But look it over here. Look over there.
But that was so much fun. We're going to do it again.
Well, I hope I'm not spoilering by saying there are diminishing returns to this plot line. But
to this show in general.
The show in general and this plot line in particular. Mm-hmm. It's like you should have just let it lie.
Yeah.
Let's let Rebecca come back into the family as Justin's girlfriend and then move along, shall we? As Robert and Kitty are moving along to adoption.
Right.
I enjoyed that scene where they said, hey, there are other kids who need a family. We'll just adopt. And I remember doing that myself and thinking, a couple of months, we'll have a baby. It'll be great.
Good luck, guys. How many years later? Yeah.
Yes. It doesn't necessarily make it that much easier.
No.
Physically, I guess. But, you know. Enjoy that home study, y'all. Don't introduce the social worker to anybody in either of the families, please. Nope. We don't know anybody. We have. We're just here by ourselves.
Yeah.
Father who flies back to Washington every so often, and Kitty Walker. So, anyway, this has got to be about the point at which Rob Lowe said, "I have gone from being a man running for president" to a guy trying to get his wife pregnant and not succeeding. What? Agent? Hello? My agent? Anything else out there? Shop me around for some comedies, will you?
Right.
So, anyway.
Well.
Season 2. There it is.
Yes.
What do we think about season 3, Catherine? Do we want to take a break? I think we should take a break.
Yes. We should take a break.
The walkers will still be there dysfunctionaling. While we're gone, they'll That's wait for right. us.
As long as they don't get Zaslav'd off Hulu.
Oh, that's true.
But if that happens, we'll deal. But
there's probably DVDs at your library.
Yes, I'm quite sure there is. So, but the good news is that Only Murders in the Building is coming back.
Yay!
For a third season. And it starts today, if you're listening to this on the day that it drops. So we are going to watch the first episode. It's called The Show Must... ... And that's all.
Yeah, so we will once again be releasing a podcast talking about an episode on the day that the next episode drops, just to refresh your memories. Make sure to listen on Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
And then we will... we will think about the walkers and decide whether after the shows we're watching, After Party and Only Murders in the Building, after they're over, do we want to come back and peek in on them? Or do we want to just say, you guys go find your missing siblings one after another? There's a lot of people with the first name of R who are that general age.
Rebecca, Ryan, and hey, Robert starts with R.
Wouldn't that be? Yeah, if William Walker may have been, it seems like the kind of guy who might not have stopped with two women, you know?
Mm-hmm.
A lot of seed to be sown. So have fun looking, guys. Maybe Detective Danner could help you out. Or the Only Murders in the Building people, move to New York and ask them to take a look around for you.
That's right.
But we, at any rate, are going to take at least a break.
Yes.
If not a permanent break.
Right.
So, speaking of looking for things, Catherine, what did you find in the library this week? It's Catherine's Library Find of the Week.
Well, this week, I have for you a coffee table book.
Oh.
A nice, you know, big, heavy, artistic tome with heavy paper. And it's filled with artful black and white portraits of chickens. The book is called Literary Chickens. So there's all these portraits, you know, close up, like Annie Leibovitz style, like black and white. You know, right up in these chickens' faces, right? And then on the facing page, there is a quote from literature. But the quotes have nothing to do with chickens. Like, when I first opened the book, I thought, okay, so the quotes are going to be like something from Shakespeare about a chicken.
Uh-huh.
No. No. They're just, there's one from Beowulf. There's one from, you know, Dickens. They're just, I guess, apparently you're supposed to, like, look deep into the chicken's
eyes. I was going to say, do they express in some way the poetic soul of the chicken?
I think that's the intention. I did not have time to really dig into that and try to determine if that's where they were going with it.
They looked deep into these chickens' tiny beady eyes.
Yes.
And apparently found the depth of their soul.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I'm like, who is this for, is my question. I mean, I do have a friend who has chickens and loves her chickens. You know, like they're cherished pets.
Uh-huh.
And there was a whole thing where one of the chickens got loose and it was like walking down the street and a stranger picked it up and was like, oh, it's my chicken now. And took it home, but they tracked it down. They found the chicken and returned her home. But yeah, I mean, she's super into her chickens. So maybe she's the kind of person that would like this, but also like it's, you know, sort of deep cuts of literary classics. So is that, I mean, would you just buy it to look at the chickens and not really care about the other stuff? I don't know. I don't know.
But that would be the sort of thing that would be a conversation starter to have on your coffee table.
Yes.
If you're having people over.
Mm-hmm.
I think that would draw some conversation.
Absolutely. Yes.
Raise some eyebrows. give you a reputation for being that person with the chicken book on their table. I would.
If you already had a reputation for having chickens, maybe.
Interesting.
Yes.
So, now, these chickens, did they have underwear on or pajamas?
They didn't. They're au naturel.
They're like, less well-dressed than the vegetables from last
week.
That's
right. Mm-hmm.
Interesting. No suits like the fruit, just naked suits. Chickens.
Right.
Well, they have feathers on, I assume. There weren't any plucked chickens, were there? That would be a little traumatic.
No. Okay. These were all quite alive and well. And, you know, circulating at the library. So that's another thing. Like, why do you check out a coffee table book from the library?
You know? Well, you're having a party.
Right.
And you say, I want to have something on my coffee table that's going to spark discussion. But of course, then it's from, if it's, you could, as soon as you open it up, you know it's from the library. And that's right. Where it takes some of the fun out that's of it, doesn't clear. It? You checked this out just to have on your table for the party.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Somebody just wanted to look at chickens for a couple of weeks.
Yep.
And God bless them.
It also makes me laugh when people put board books for little kids on hold. I'm like, isn't that the kind of thing where you just go to the library, browse around, your kid gets, you know, is drawn to something, and you take it home for a little while? No, yeah. I mean, sometimes they get, people request them from other libraries.
Oh my gosh.
And put them on hold. I'm like, it's a board book.
Like, are board books suddenly like $25 each or something? You just go to Barnes & Noble, you throw a few in a...
But I mean, like, this is like, I really want this specific one. That's the part that I don't understand.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I'm just actually unsure about the whole concept of checking out a board book from the library.
Right.
Because to me, a board book is something that's going in a kid's mouth.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would like 100%. To buy, I would like to buy one that has only my children's germs on it, please. Right.
Yes.
Do they spray them with Lysol when they come back in or anything?
Nope.
Or they just pop them back on the shelf.
That would be me. That would be my job if we did. We
put them in a protective plastic case of some sort.
Mm-mm.
Man.
And we also have, like, remember I talked about the kits of toys and books that and I did ask, I'm like, do we clean these when they come in? Like the ones that are for babies? And my coworker was like, no.
Wow.
Because we have like cleaning materials, because sometimes you have to clean something off of a book, you know, like sometimes there's sticky stuff or God knows what on a book. So we have like wipes and erasers and things like that to clean them. So
are these toys that like the person checking them out could safely clean themselves,
or
are they gonna ruin something?
I mean, certain, like not the puppets or whatever, but yeah, there's like plastic things that if I were that parent, I would
before and
wipe
after
it down.
Yeah. Yikes. Well, you
anyway,
know.
That was a side, note on the literary chickens. We wandered over into board books.
Yes. Is the literary chicken, are people putting the literary chickens on hold?
That I don't know.
Are they just happening upon it when they come into the library? Yeah. I mean, squealing that, with delight.
Right. I don't think I encountered that in the circumstance of a hold. But
interesting.
It could happen.
Yeah.
Now that we've talked about it.
It's hard to hold a chicken, though. You have to put it in a pan.
That's right. So, anyway, speaking of libraries and archives and catalogs, we, every week, like to take a little spin through our archives and see what we were talking about 2 years ago, 5 years ago, and, Terri, 8 years ago.
Wow. We've been talking for a long time. Every now and then you guys listening think, have they run out of things to talk about? I think they're just yammering. 8 years. More than eight years. It's been a long time. And that was episode 80, the one that was 8 years ago. So, and we were doing them weekly then. So, golly.
Yep.
Anyway. Yes. Yeah, well, I noticed the one from 2 years ago was called The Emptying Nest, and I think it was Nicole, right?
Yes.
And now it is your turn, Catherine, to have an empty nest. I will never have an empty nest, so I just abstain from this conversation. But how's it feeling to think about both your kids being out? Are you making plans for your son's closet?
his closet that he turned into his little office.
Is that going to be your office now?
No, I would not. I don't understand how he can, like, you know, there's no windows. There's no, like, it's claustrophobic, you know. It's not comfortable, in my opinion.
It's the kind of thing that's fun when you're a kid because it's like, ooh, I'm using a space in a non-traditional way.
Yes.
This is so cool. But yes. When you're an adult, you're like, I need to be able to spread out. Yes. I got a lot of junk.
And I need windows. Like, even we have a home office in our house, and I don't use it to work in because it only has one window that just looks at the neighbor's roof. You know, like, I'd like to be in the dining room because then I have lots of windows and stuff to look at.
You know what also that closet would be perfect for? That podcasting. Closet should be your podcasting studio.
That's true. I could do that.
Yeah. Put some foam all over the walls. Mm-hmm. Egg cartons.
Right. Yes, absolutely.
I'm sure he wouldn't mind.
But I'm just looking forward to, like, deep cleaning his bedroom when he leaves. Like, that needs to be done. Ah. So, yes, we've started kind of a pile. I think I talked about this a couple weeks ago, but, you know, we have a little pile that we're starting in my daughter's room because she's not using that. Uh-huh. So that's the home base for all the stuff. And, you know, I'm like, we need, you know, sheets and towels and that kind of thing. That's the main thing we still have left to buy. We found a little refrigerator, and the roommate is bringing the microwave. So,
cats.
Yep. They've been talking. So yeah. And we talked about this a couple weeks ago, but
yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's weird. It's definitely weird.
And no taking a kid to school.
I know. Like, I still follow the schools, the school district on Facebook, and, you know, starting to see things here and there. And I'm like, doesn't apply. Doesn't matter. Don't care. Don't need to know.
Yeah, it's fun to still follow that and then go, nope, yep, not me.
Not me. I'm good. Thanks anyway.
Yeah. So, yeah.
And they are opening, you know, they built a new high school. Uh-huh. And it's going to open this fall. And in a few weeks, they're having, like, an open house where people can go check it out and walk around in it. And I see that listed as an event on Facebook, and, like, these are all your mutual friends who are interested. And I'm like, I don't know. I don't really need to. I'll get there sooner or later, I'm sure. I don't need to, like, go to this thing. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, good luck.
Yeah.
Just you and your husband.
I know.
Think of all the projects.
And the dogs.
And the dogs. Yes. Dogs have to step up their participation in the family now that they are one half of the at-home members.
That's right. Well, they're pretty good about, like, wanting to be where everyone else is at all times.
Yeah, I think that's what the deal is with my dog laying completely across the hallways, is that nobody can go anywhere without her knowing it.
Yes.
So she can keep tabs on us very She's well.
Keeping an eye on things. Yes. Absolutely.
Well, we're talking about the notices of back to school and all that stuff. That sort of also ties into the thing we were talking about 8 years ago, which was summer transitions into and out of school. Mm-hmm. You still will have those just for college.
Right.
Presumably kids are coming home. Well, your daughter isn't coming home for summers, so, but your son might.
Right.
But our life is completely homogenous now, one day like the other.
Right.
Regardless of the season, and it's so lovely. as we discussed 8 years ago, transitions out of school and into summer, and then out of summer back to school were always really difficult. They were huge times of disruption for us. I had kids who needed a routine. Mm-hmm. And every time you had to move from one routine to another, there was a very bumpy patch. And then after my kids were finally out of college, my daughter was working for a while as an aide in the school district. So she still had that out and in. And it was even a problem for her as an adult. And, you know, she couldn't find a job in the summer. So she was just sitting around at home, and that was bad. But then now they're both working at jobs that are the same all year through, and it's so perfect, and it's so nice. And I do not miss that transition at all. You know, people keep asking, oh, it's summer. Are you going to go away for a trip? And it's like, nah, we don't do that anymore.
We're good.
We just, it's just the same. We just want more of that same. Can we have some more same? Same is good.
Yeah, we've, you know, this will be starting to become, you know, towards the end of our having summer. We'll see. But, you know, as you said, my daughter hasn't been, she only came back her first summer, which was like the summer of 2021. And it was still like the tail end of COVID stuff, you know. So she's done coming home, I think. Yeah. And she's like, I love Michigan. Like, okay, fine. And we'll see what happens with my son. I mean, his school, it's very much like everybody lives in the dorms. So he's probably not going to be living off campus, in which case it would be hard for him to have a place in the summer. So he probably will come home more frequently. So we'll see.
Yeah.
We'll see how that goes. I don't know.
I'm sure he'll like to come back to the loving embrace of his family and the constant supervision thereof. It'll be great. Yeah. He won't mind it at all. Oh, well, and it will get us thinking about those little kid days, which you were talking about 5 years ago. And gosh, I have a hard time even remembering the little kid days. Other than that, the transitions into summer were disruptive, but I'm trying to think if there are older kid days that I miss now. I mean, I'm just talking about the disruptions, and this was still a thing when they were in college, but the period where my son was in college, and my daughter was too for part of it, and I would go every day, I would drive him there, and then I would just camp out in the dining hall while he went to his classes and do my work. That was kind of fun. I remember those days fondly. And he was, you know, whether he was engaged with his classes or not, people knew him and seemed to like him, and that was fun. And I got good work done there.
Yeah. I find I usually get stuff done if I, you know, take my laptop somewhere, if I'm waiting for a kid or doing something. Yeah.
Because there's nothing else to do.
Yeah.
I mean, you can go scroll the social media, but still, basically,
and it's a good focusing. It feels like a little, you know, for me, it would usually end up being a coffee shop or some place. So it feels a little bit like a little treat to, you know, be away from home. And well, I'm here, so I have to order something.
That was fun. And I got to know some of the kids who were always in the dining hall at the same time I was. And one time they asked me for blood and I went and gave some. And it just, I felt like I was a little bit in the life of the college there.
Right. Yeah, I mean, and I think, you know, it's only been a couple months since my son got his license. And before that, there were all those times where we were driving together. And, you know, of course, a lot of the time it was, this is really taking away from my ability to work. But also, you know, and I knew, and you've experienced it too, how it is a good way to spend time with a kid, for sure.
Yeah, I do miss when my son had a job that was like a good half hour away and I would have to take him and bring him home.
Yeah.
I would take him and then I would go sit in the local library.
Read about chickens.
6 hours. For 6 hours and do work and then go pick him up and drive home. And we had great conversations. He's not somebody who really talks, but he was captive. Yeah. So I do miss that too.
Yeah.
That's an older kid.
Right.
Days. I don't miss that long drive. It's nice that he now works very close, but those conversations were nice. I wish I could find another venue for them.
Yeah. And similarly, like during that 2020-2021 school year, when it was like COVID disruptions, like up the wazoo, like, you know, every week or every month they're like, okay, we're redoing the schedule, like, completely. And there was a quite some time where, like, they were encouraging the kids to go out of the building for lunch.
Oh, gee.
And at the very beginning of the year, like, this they could just eat out. Like, he would pack a lunch and eat outside. And but then, you know, as the weather turned and sort of things were not going well at school. And, you know, and so basically I ended up just picking him up for lunch. And we would sit in the car together. And, you know, it was, the circumstances were not good.
No.
But it was still something that, you know, we did.
And, oh, some nice together time.
Yeah. Yeah.
And a break for him in the middle of the day to be with somebody.
Right.
Sympathetic.
Right. Exactly. Aww. So I wouldn't really want to put him through that again for sure. But, you know, it definitely had, it had some.
These are the things you can't post about on social media. There's no little meme for these things, like first day of school and the graduation and look at the concert and the recital. But it's like they're still meaningful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we hope this podcast is still meaningful for you, listeners. And if not, just go play it anyway. Just go run it anyway. It'll be fine. Right. Let about 100 episodes go by. But that's it for the Parenting Roundabout weekly roundup for this week. You can find all our episodes on Spreaker, Apple Podcasts, Amazon Music, or wherever you get your podcasts. You can find recaps, links, and an opportunity to comment on our website at parentingroundabout.com. You can also talk to us on our Facebook page, on Instagram, or on Twitter. Or are we calling it X now? That sounds so unfriendly. I tip my hat to Elon Musk. He's having a good time, but I'm still going to call it Twitter, where you'll find us at Roundabout Chat. And please visit our Amazon shop at amazon.com/shop/momitude, where you can find links to a lot of the things we've talked about over the years. We'll see you back here next Tuesday. Goodbye, Catherine.
Bye, Terri.
Goodbye, everybody.